What is your name, please?
My name is Grace Earle.
What is your name, please?
My name is Grace Earle.
What is your name, please?
My name is Grace Earle.
Two of these people are imposters. Only one of them is the real Grace Earle, and is the only one sworn to tell the truth. And here is our host, Bud Collier.
Thank you, and good evening, and welcome once again to our game of deliberate misrepresentation, in which our panel endeavors to figure out which one of two challengers has sworn to tell the truth. To Tell the Truth is brought to you each week by Geritol, America's number one tonic, the high-potency tonic that helps you feel stronger fast. And now let's meet our cross-examiners. What is your name, please?
My name is Polly Bergen.
My name is Ralph Bellamy.
My name is Kitty Carlisle.
And my name is High Gardner.
Now, these three people all claim to be Grace Earle. Only one is the real Grace Earle. The other two have merely assumed that identity, and they do not have to stick to the truth. Now, panel, may I direct your attention to your copies of an affidavit while I read from the original. I, Grace Earle, have been a telephone operator in Washington, D.C. for more than 25 years. I started in government service in 1935 and have worked in one place through three administrations. I am now the chief telephone operator at the White House. Signed, Grace Earle. All right, panel, these three ladies all claim to be Grace Earle. As you heard, chief telephone operator at the White House. Only the real Grace Earle is sworn to answer your questions truthfully, and each of you will question as usual until you hear this signal. At the end of the questioning period, you will, of course, be asked to register your vote for the one who, in your opinion, is the real Grace Earle. And we'll start with Polly Burton. Polly?
Number one, the first newspaper woman was recently named the post of Jim Haggerty's assistant at the White House. Could you give me her name, please?
Grace Dawn.
Number two, how many private lines does Mr. Eisenhower have?
One.
One? Number two, could you tell me, name the people who can be directly connected with the president himself? Number two.
The number?
No, the people who can be connected directly with the president by phone.
All of the White House staff and cabinet members.
They can be connected without being announced to the president.
No, everyone would be announced.
Oh, everyone must be announced, I see.
Ralph Bellamy.
Well, number one, I suppose we ought to find out what's the White House telephone number.
Number one, National 81414.
Well, I happen to know that's right. what's the...
You're both.
Number one, what's the president's office extension number?
His office extension is 31.
Number two, what's your answer to that?
32.
Number three, what's your answer to that?
33 and 34.
Number one, who answers the president's extension?
His secretary.
Number two, what's his secretary's name?
Personal secretary.
Yes.
Ann Whitman.
Kitty Carlisle.
Number three, you've been chief operator at the White House for 25 years, and you've been through three administrations. Who made the most telephone calls? President Truman, President Roosevelt, or President Eisenhower?
President Roosevelt.
Why?
He lived there the longest.
Oh. Number two, how do you eliminate nut calls? Now, we're not very important, but we get a few, and I wonder how they do it at the White House.
We ask who's calling and ask what their name is. If the name is not recognized, why...
You don't put them through. Number two, do you have priority... I mean, number one, do you have priority on long-distance phone calls, or do you have to do like we do, wait and they say, the circuits are busy, madam?
We have priority.
You do.
Hi, Gardner.
Number one, does the president ever accept collect calls?
That depends.
Also, number one, when you answer the phone at the White House, what do you say?
Good afternoon. To whom do you wish to speak?
Number two, how do you acknowledge the call?
White House.
Number three?
This is the White House.
Number two, what department stores do you shop in Washington?
Garfinkel's.
Mm-hmm. Any others?
Woodward and Lothrop.
And what newspapers do you read?
Washington Star.
And others?
The Morning Post.
And what do you read, number one, in Washington?
The Washington Post.
Uh-huh.
Okay, that's it. It's time to vote, panel. So without consultation, will you mark your ballots? And by so doing, you will select, of course, number one, number two, or number three. I remind you that the team of challengers receives $250 for every incorrect vote. All right, now, Polly, you raised such a fuss last week about always being called on first, and I...
But I'm ready.
I'm sorry. I'm reversing the order. Hi, Gardner.
Well, I voted for number two. I was going to vote for number one, who's a redhead, but I realized it was impossible because they wouldn't let anything red into the White House.
Ooh. Kitty, how about your vote?
I voted for number three. Well, I once called the White House, and if my memory serves me, the voice sounds familiar.
And how about you, Ralph?
Number two. I kind of suspect number three. We didn't ask her very much, but number two, frankly, had a voice that sounded like a telephone voice.
Oh, you number droppers, you. Holly, how about you? Have you ever called the White House?
I never talked to the White House, but I voted for number two because... When the three of them were standing up there, she said, Grace Earle. She sort of ran her name together, as I think you would if you were used to carrying it around for a long time. And the other two were a little more proper when they said it.
All right, there are our reasons, and there are our votes. Let's see how well yours compare with our panel now as we find out which one of these three ladies is the chief telephone operator at the White House. Will the real Grace Earle please stand up? All right, now let's see. Number one, would you tell us who you really are and what you do?
My name is Helen McLaughlin. I am information clerk at the Commodore Hotel, New York.
And number three, how about you?
My name is Madeline Hoey. I own Plumbridge Custom Candies for the carriage trade.
I gather you hit a sweet tooth in Kitty. Let's see how we racked up here. Our panel was pretty smart, as a matter of fact. Three of them guessed right, which means there was only one incorrect vote at $250 for that total from Geritol. Thank you very much, ladies. Good night, and good luck to you. Of challenges, please.
What is your name, please?
My name is Tom Carpenter.
What is your name, please?
My name is Tom Carpenter.
What is your name, please?
My name is Tom Carpenter.
All right, panel, especially you ladies, if you can wrest your gazes away from those three handsome stalwarts, will you follow along with your copies of this affidavit? I, Tom Carpenter, am cadet captain and commander of the 2nd Regiment of the Corps of Cadets at the United States Military Academy. I have won my varsity letter in a major sport. This summer, as a first classman, I was selected King of the Beasts at West Point. Signed, Tom Carpenter. Now, as you heard, panel, these three gentlemen all claim to be Tom Carpenter, West Point cadet. Remember, only the real Tom Carpenter is required to answer your questions truthfully. And let's begin this round with Kitty Carlisle. Kitty?
Number one, what is King of the Beast?
Well, the King of the Beast is a name given to a firstie. By firstie, I mean goes as a senior in college. The King of the Beast, there's actually two of these King of the Beasts. The new class coming in is divided into halves. and a firstie is designated to head up one of these halves. In other words, the king of the beasts is in charge of
the
indoctrinating
beginner.
The new class, bringing them in
see.
The proper manner.
Number two, it says here that you're a commander of the 2nd Regiment of the Corps of Cadets. What are your duties as commander of the Corps of Cadets?
Well, essentially, I'm responsible for the discipline, and everything that goes on within the 2nd Regiment is my responsibility.
I see. Number three, what is the British equivalent of West Point?
Sandhurst, ma'am.
And number one, what is the French equivalent of West Point?
St. Cyr.
Hi, Gardner. Number one, you won a letter in what sport?
That's correct, sir. They I won in swimming, sir.
In swimming?
That's right, sir.
Uh-huh. Number two, what is the name of a very, very hilly city very close to West Point?
Highland Falls, I believe, sir.
Number three, what is the name of the famous hotel that folks stay at when they visit West Point?
The Hotel Fair, sir.
Number one, yes. What is the name of the air base affiliated with West Point?
The air base is Stewart Air Force Base, sir.
Number two, how close to West Point is the Stewart Field?
I'd estimate about 25 miles, sir.
How far away would you say it was, number three?
About 17, sir.
And you, number one?
20 miles, sir.
Thank you.
That's a fast man with a quip. How about you, Polly?
See, they're all so beautiful, aren't they? Number one, what happens to a cadet if he doesn't kiss a girl at Kissing Rock on Flirtation Walk?
Well, ma'am, this Kissing Rock, there's a tradition behind it. If you don't kiss your drag, that's your date at the time, the foundations of the academy will crumble.
I understand the building standing quite well.
Yes, ma'am.
Number two, more and more women are going into the armed services. Do you believe there will ever be a time when West Point will admit women?
Well, that's
and
a little hard
so,
to
would
answer,
you let me know immediately?
Ralph Bellamy. Ralph, before you start, may I tell you what a swell job I thought you did on the closed door the other night?
Oh, thank you. Number one, does the date November 30th mean anything to you?
Certainly does, sir. That's the day Army's going to roll right over that Navy team.
Number two, who particularly distinguished the recent West Point reunion?
President Dwight Eisenhower.
Number three, who is the present commandant at West Point?
Present commandant is Lieutenant General Garrison H. Davidson, sir.
Number one, how long has he been there?
He's been there, Guard Davidson. He's a lieutenant general. He came there. He's been an instructor there before. He was a coach of the team.
How long has he
been?
Well,
President now, he's been there 5 years, sir.
Number two, how many children does he have?
I believe he has six, sir.
Number three, how many children?
Five, sir.
Number one, how many children does he have?
Lieutenant General Davidson has five children, sir.
Five children.
I would say he has five or six.
All right. A lot of children.
Time to vote once again, so with no consultation, will you please mark your ballots, panel? And in so doing, oh, stop grinning like that, Polly. Will you vote for number one, number two, or number three? Are you all ready, Polly?
Yes, sir.
All right. Hi, Gardner. What was your vote?
Do you want it or do you want me to give it to Polly?
No, I want your vote.
It'll be wrong.
We're giving Polly time to think.
I thought it was number one for a while. I voted for three because I thought number one was knew so much about the point that he might be an instructor rather than a cadet. So I went for number three.
Kitty?
I voted for number three. On the basis of his voice, he sounded like he had a voice of command to me.
Mm-hmm. Ralph, how about your choice?
Number two. I can't give you much of a reason, just a hunch. They all had pretty good information, just a hunch.
Now, how about yours, Polly?
I voted for number three, and it's something about the way he carries his neck. It sort of seems to be pushed in a little more than the other two.
Voted for him because he has a pushed-in neck?
Well, you know what I mean.
I hope I do.
That's pointy. Yeah.
Huh?
Carriage is more West Pointy.
Thank you, Kitty. Mm-hmm.
Carriage is more West Pointy. All right, there are our votes and there are our reasons. Let's see how you stack up with our panel this time as we find out which of these fine stalwarts is the real West Point cadet. Will the real Tom Carpenter please stand up? right. Number one, tell us who you really are and what you do.
My name is Paul Kaufman. I'm an ensign in the United States Coast Guard. I'm presently stationed on the weather cutter, North Atlantic cutter, Mackinac.
Thank you, sir. And number three, how about you?
My name is Mike Haraka, and I'm a truck driver for the Market Basket.
Has anyone
I'll
ever...
I'll tell you something. There's something about driving a truck, it'll push your neck in every time. Quickly, Polly, what? I haven't got much time.
It's probably from avoiding New York taxi cabs.
That's probably it. Gentlemen, there were 1, 2, 3 incorrect votes at $250 each for a total of $750 from Geritol. Thank you very much. Good night and good luck to you. And we'll meet a new set of challenges in just a moment. Here's please. What is your name, please?
My name is Norman Rehm.
What is your name, please?
My name is Norman Rehm.
What is your name, please?
My name is Norman Rehm.
Once again, panel, may I direct your attention to your copies of this affidavit. I, Norman Rehm, hold the world's record for aqualung diving. I once reached a depth of 370 feet. Later this month, I will try a dive to 400 feet. No aqualung diver has ever reached that depth and lived. Signed, Norman Rehm. Gentlemen all claim to be the world's champion aqualung diver, Norman Rehm. So again, question until you hear the signal. We'll begin this round with Ralph Bellamy. Ralph?
Number one, how long is a lung good for? How long can you stay under with it?
That depends on the depth.
Well, at your 370-foot dive, how long did it take you?
To get there?
To get there.
About 2.5 minutes.
2.5 minutes. Number two, how long did it take you?
Minute and a half, sir.
Number three, how long did it take?
2.5 minutes.
2.5 minutes? How long will it take you to get to 400 feet? Number one.
How long would it?
How long will it take you, this dive is proposed?
About 4 minutes.
Number two, do you use a compression tank from this depth when you come up? Decompression tank?
Oh, yes. I mean, I use the tanks that I have on.
Well, I mean, to avoid bends, do you have to...
Oh, yes, indeed. It's very carefully regulated all the way up.
Number three, where will you make this 400-foot dive?
In Key Largo, Florida.
Kitty Carlisle.
Number one, what do you get when you go down 370 feet?
Cold.
Number two, why do you want to go down 400 feet?
Well, like the man said when he climbed the mountain, because it's there.
Number three, how far down can a pearl diver go? Without any equipment.
The depth for oxygen alone is 33 feet.
How much?
33 feet.
33 feet.
They go beyond that, but that's the depth that you should go.
And how long can he stay down without equipment?
About two minutes.
Could you stay down, number one, 2 minutes without equipment?
No, ma'am.
Could you, number two?
1 minute.
You have stayed down 1 minute.
I have.
Number three, what do you get when you go down to 370 feet?
Cold.
Nobody brings anything
There's
up?
No warm water down there. Hi, Gardner.
Number one, how deep does the Andrea Doria lie in the Atlantic?
About 230 feet.
Do you know the name of the department store, the member of the department store clan who went down to explore the Andrea Doria?
Yes, Peter Gimble.
Peter Gimble. Number two, who recently wrote a book about aqualung diving?
Ramsey Parks, I believe.
Do you know number three?
Yes, Ramsey Parks.
And how about you, number one?
Not that I know of.
Uh-huh. Number one, incidentally, you know how to swim, don't you?
Yes.
Number two, is it necessary to know how to swim to use an aqualung? Number one, may I ask that question?
Pardon?
Do you have to know how to swim in order to use an aqualung?
Not necessarily.
Also, Ollie, you did it again.
I caught
you.
Number three, who invented the aqualung?
Dumas.
What is his full name?
Dumas.
What is his full name?
Aqualung?
No, Dumas' full name.
Well, the full name of it, actually, aqualung is a trade name. The actual form...
No, I meant the full name of the gentleman who invented it.
I don't know Dumas' last name.
I see. Number two, who is Gusteau?
He's a French diver, done most of his diving in France and in the Red Sea.
Number three, Gusteau was one of the first devotees of aqualung. Could you tell me the film, the first silent film that he made using an aqualung?
That's The Silent World.
Number one.
That's it. Time to vote. So will you please mark your ballots once again? And this time you will select, of course, as you have before, either number one, or number two, or number three. Polly, would you like to be reinstated this time?
Oh, now you ask me.
Ah. I'm ready. This time you're not ready.
All right.
All right, Polly. For whom did you vote?
Well, I voted for number three. I'll tell you honestly, I thought Gusteau invented the aqualung. Perhaps I'm wrong, but I know a little bit about aqualungs, and they all gave, you know, had a lot of information. I feel that number three was a little bit more thorough with his information than the other two.
Ralph, how about your selection?
Number one. I haven't got much of a reason again. He said his name rather easily, and he seemed to have a lot of information.
How about yours, Kitty?
Number one. Well, he looks like a man who's been wrestling with the deep for quite a while. And I just thought that when he said he couldn't go down as far as a pearl diver, it sounded authentic.
And whom did you pick, I?
I voted for number one, too, because he did not know the name of the author of a book I didn't know either. And secondly, he looks like a fellow who enjoys going into dives.
Oh, well, we'll pass that one over in a hurry with a large batch of geritol. And if our minds are made up, let's see how yours are and how they compare with ours as we discover which one of these three gentlemen is the real world's champion aqualung diver. Will the real Norman Ream please stand up? Thank you very much, sir. Number two, would you tell us who you are and what you really do?
My name is Bob O'Dell. I was an airline pilot in Afghanistan, and now I'm trying to get a job in TV production.
And number three, how about you, sir?
I'm Jack Renner. I'm sales manager for Sandler Medical Gas in New York. And among other things, we make oxygen and sell it.
Well, we thank you very much. The panel was smart again, and there was only one incorrect vote for a total of $250 from Geritol. Hope you enjoyed your visit, gentlemen. We enjoyed having you here. Good night and good luck. Now we'll return to our panel in just a minute.
Three.
Well, I guess that's all the time we have for tonight, except for me to remind every one of you watching our show and here in the studio not to forget to watch the Polly Bergen show on Saturday night. If you miss our Polly, you're crazy. And now say good night to you, panel. Good night.
Good night. Good night, bud.
And all of the rest of you, don't forget that we are brought to you each week by Geritol, the fast-acting, high-potency tonic that helps you feel stronger fast. Now, this is Bud Collier saying good night and reminding you to tell the truth. Good night, everybody.
Caution, Catch-21 fever is catching. Symptoms may include muscle spasms, loss of...
What is your name, please?
My name is Jean Béliveau.
What is your name, please?
My name is Jean Béliveau.
What is your name, please?
My name is Jean Béliveau.
Two of these people are imposters. Only one of them is the real Jean Béliveau, and is the only one sworn to tell the truth.